In the low spurs of the mountains, and were almost at the top of the main range, when life seemed to go out of everything, leaving the world dead, so suddenly silent the forest became, so stagnant the air. Perfect silence, the crushing silence of deep forests at night, and more, for always, even in the most impenetrable fastnesses of the wooded mountains, is the multitudinous murmur of little lives, awakened by the darkness, exaggerated and intensified by the stillness of the air and the great dark. Atmosphere seemed to lie upon the body like the weight of sea on a diver who has ventured too far into its awful depths.
Thank you.
side of the cursed mountains, anywhere. Goal was of no account. We had but one impulse, to get away from that place. As far as the eye could see stretched a level plain of ashy white, faintly phosphorescent, a sea of velvet fog that lay like motionless water, or rather like a floor of alabaster, so dense did it appear, so seemingly capable of sustaining weight. If it were possible, I think that sea of dead white mist struck even greater terror into my soul than the heavy silence or the deadly cry, so ominous was it, so utterly unreal, so phantasmal, so impossible, as it lay there like a dead ocean under the steady stars. Late in September, I chose a bright, warm, still day, the last smile of the dying summer, and started early in the morning along the path that led to Hallsburg. The path was hardly visible, merely the worn road of some small beasts, for, though it showed in the crisp grass, the bushes above grew thick and hardly penetrable. The land rose slowly, and rising grew clearer, until at last I came out on a great slope of hill, unbroken by trees or shrubs, very like my memory of that rise of land we had topped in order that we might find the dead valley and the icy fog. There lay the dead valley. A great oval basin, almost as smooth and regular as though made by man. In the midst of the basin, perhaps a mile and a half away, the level expanse was broken by a great dead tree, rising leafless and gaunt into the air. I was driven by an overwhelming curiosity, and there seemed to be but one thing in the world to do, to get to that tree. As I drew near the skeleton tree, I noticed the glint of sunlight on a kind of white mound around its roots, and I wondered curiously. It was not until I had come close that I saw its nature. All around the roots and barkless trunk was heaped a wilderness of little bones. Tiny skulls of rodents and of birds, thousands of them, rising about the dead tree and streaming off for several yards in all directions, until the dreadful pile ended in isolated skulls and scattered skeletons. Here and there a larger bone appeared, the thigh of a sheep, the hoofs of a horse, and to one side, grinning slowly, a human skull. I stood quite still, staring with all my eyes, when suddenly the dense silence was broken by a faint cry high over my head. Saw a great falcon turning and sailing downward just over the tree. In a moment more she fell motionless on the bleaching bones. I stood dazed and frozen. The sun was sinking, red and dull, towards the line of hills. In the east the dark was growing fast. Was there still time? The sky was cold under the setting sun, but below was the ashy gray of death. I stood for a moment on the brink of the sea of hell, and then leaped down the slope. The sunset opened before me, the night closed behind, and as I crawled home weak and tired, darkness shut down on the dead valley.